SASI is, SASI means SS table attached secondary index. So this is a new implementation of the classical secondary index, which follow the SS table lifecycle. Thus the name, right? The objective is to give more performant and more capable secondary index implementation. Who has implemented it? So we should thank this team of engineers. So this is their public GitHub profile. Those people have spent a bunch of time implementing this secondary index. So there are five of them. Why is it better than the native secondary index? First, because it follows SS table lifecycle. We can perform some optimization in the index structure. With SASI, we have a new data structure, which is a B plus three like data structure, okay? You can do range query now with the secondary index, and we have also full text search option. Great. Let's start with some demo. Let's be crazy. So here I have, I'm using Zeppelin, a notebook, to query my data in Cassandra. So I have a table which is called anbum, and I create a bunch of index on my table. The first one is on the title column using SASI index, using the mode contains, which means that it will allow me to query substring in the title. I am using the standard analyzer, so it will split my title into tokens, perform some tokenization, stemming, skip stop world, normalize to lowercase. I want also to be able to search my album using the artist name, so I create an index on the artist name, mode contains. But this time, I don't need to split the artist name into token, right? So I will use non-tokenizing analyzer. I want to be able to search my album by country, so I create an index on country, prefix, mode, non-tokenizing analyzer. Last but not least, I create also an index on the year column, which is a numeric column. So in this case, I cannot specify an analyzer class because it is a numeric column. Okay. How many albums do I have in my data set? Don't do this in your production, right? It is evil. It is just for my demo. It will take a while because Zeppelin will start a new JVM to start the Cassandra interpreter. Okay, fine. 110,000, approximately, album. Okay. Now, let's say I want to query my data. Give me all the album where the title contains songs, the world songs, released in USA between 40 and 2010. Well, give me only 1,000 rows. I don't want to fetch the whole database. Okay. So here you are, song. So here we see we have full text search. Why? Because I put the keyword song, but SASI also returned me this album, songs. Because we have full text search, it will stem the songs into the root, which is song, right? If I modify to sing, let's see what we have here. Sing, sings. Do we have some singing? Singing, yeah. So this is the effect of tokenization and stemming. Now let's say we want to use contains mods. Love. Let's see how many songs do we have with love. Okay. Love. Blah, blah, blah. Let me find something interesting. No lovers. No lover. No glove. Demo effect. Now let's say I want dance and chair. The chairman dances. Why? Well, dances, dance, same word. Chair, chairman, same thing. Tokenization, right? Very powerful. You can now change the country to United Kingdom. Love, or love. Okay, and so on. Gets back to the slide. Okay, you have seen SASI in action, full text search with French query and so on, multiple criteria. Cluster-wide, how does it work? What you should know is all the secondary indices in Cassandra are distributed index. What does it mean? It means that the index data will be co-located with your original data. Imagine that you have an index on a user country. So here on node A, we have some user from UK. So UK is the key country, and the values are user, a list of user. But the same index can be found in on another node. Here on node E, you have also some English users, right? So all the indices are distributed on the cluster. So when you query data using secondary index, we are using an algorithm to scan the cluster. First, the core editor will issue a query with a concurrency factor. It will hit some node. Not all of them, because imagine you have a cluster of 1,000 nodes, you don't want to hit all of them, right? So the first round of query will hit some of them. If it doesn't get enough results because you put a high limit, limit 1,000, 10,000, the coordinator will issue a second round of query by increasing the concurrency factor, right? And so on, if you don't have enough result, it will increase the concurrency with a third round of query until it fetches enough data. This is the formula of the concurrency factor in the source code. Okay, so max of one, min, blah, 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 blah. I have written a deep dive blog post you can find here. Now, the problem with SASI is this is the source code of SASI right now. It returns mean value, long mean value for estimated result rows, so which is a negative value. So if you take, if you apply this formula, you have a max between 1 and negative value, so it will be 1. So for the first round of query using SASI right now, the concurrency factor is always equals to 1. It will be increased for the second round, but the first round is only 1. Some caveats. If you don't have restrictive filter, well, the coordinator will scan all the cluster. There is no magic, sorry. The solution is please always use limit. It doesn't make sense to fetch 10 million of rows, right? Except for analytic use case, but we will deal with it after. Second caveat, very, very tricky. Imagine that you have a one-to-one index. For example, you create an index on user email. For one email address, how many users do you expect to get back? Maximum one, maybe zero, right? So let's see the sequence. First round, not found. Second round, not found, and so on. In the best case, you will get one result back when you finish scanning all the cluster. In the worst case, zero result. So if you have one-to-one index relationship, maybe you want to use materialized view. Because in this case, you will hit only one node. But if you require range query, well, materialized view doesn't work with range query, right? So you still need this index. Last caveat, imagine that you want to fetch all the rows in your table using SASI to filter down for analytics use case. Well, in this case, I will recommend using a co-located Spark. It will push down the filtering on each local Cassandra. And you will not send out the data on the network. Local read and write paths. Index files are built when you have memtable flush on disk. So as soon as Cassandra flushes the memtable, it will also build SASI index files. And it will be built also on compaction flush, right? To avoid out of memory issue, index files are split into chunks of 1 GB for memtable flush. And you have also a parameter you can tune for compaction flush, which is this one. In memory, when your data are staying in memory, in memtable, SASI will also create the equivalent of index memtable. If you are using a text data type and prefix mode, it will use a modified version of the Guava concurrent radix tree. For the contents mode, it will use concurrent suffix tree. And for all the data types, it will use a modified version of JDK concurrent skip list set. Be very careful with the sparse mode. It is not very well documented, but the sparse mode is only suitable for 1 to n index with n maximum 5. If you exceed 5, so for example, for one value of my index, I expect maximum 5 Cassandra rows. If you go more than 5, you will have an exception in your logs, and it will stop indexing this row. How does it work on disk? So this is my SS table, and this is my on disk index file. So in this example, I'm indexing user country, right? Because my SS table are all immutable, in the on disk index file, I can store the offset of each partition from the beginning of the SS table, right? So I store the offset in my index file, so when I'm reading back the raw data, I can skip a bunch of bytes. And it will be very fast. And this kind of optimization is only possible because index files are following the same life cycle as SS table. So for the local read path, first, your query are sent to the query planner, who you see later, to optimize the predicates. Then SASI will load chunks of 4 kilobytes of data, of index data, from disk into memory. Why 4 kilobytes? Well, because this is the block size of modern drive, SSD or spinning disk, right? So instead of loading the whole index file in memory, it will just load chunks of 4 kilobytes to perform binary search, to find the index value. And when it has found the index value, it will get also the offset of the partition. It will populate the partition key cache directly. So when you are going to ask Cassandra to read the real data from your SS table, the partition key cache is already hot. One important detail. Currently, SASI only keep partition key offset in the index structure. So if you have very wide partition, it will not be as efficient as you can think. So how does it work? Well, in fact, it will first load into memory. This is a diagram of the index file. The root pointer block, okay? And then it will perform some binary search to go down to the pointer level until the data block, where you can find the offset of your partition in the original SS table. So for example, if you are searching a numeric value in each pointer block, you have the mean and the max value of your numeric. So if the search value is less than this one, it will go on the left. It is bigger than this one, it will go on the right. So it's the basic binary search, right? The query planner. The function of the query planner is to build a predicate tree out of your query, to push down predicates, to reorganize them, to optimize them. Let's take a simple example. This is your predicate, where age less than 100, first name start with P, but first name different than PA, and age bigger than 21. So this is the original predicate tree. First pass through the query optimizer. Because the end clause is associative and commutative, we can merge those two branches together, right? Here we have an exclusion, first name different than PA. So exclusion, the different operator is transformed into exclusion on the range scan. So during the search of first name starting with P, we will exclude all value starting with PA. Right. Last but not least, those two branches can be merged together, again, because N is associative and commutative operation. So this is the final, on the right, you have the final predicate tree optimized. Some benchmarks. So for the benchmark, I had access to 13 bare metal machines, 6 CPU hyper-threading, 64 gigabytes of RAM, a bunch of SSD, so I don't have any disk I/O issue. For the data set, I generated 30 billions of rows, so to match the number of machines, so approximately 1 billion of rows per machine. I have one numerical index with 36 distinct values, 2 text index with 7 distinct values, and 1 text index with only 3 distinct values. What does it mean? It means that my indices are very dense. Right? You have only 3 distinct values for 30 billions of rows. I did a full table scan using a co-located Spark with no limit. So here are the results. If I give only one predicate, one filter, it will fetch 36 million of rows. It took me approximately 600 seconds. The more you increase the number of predicates, the less row you will get out, and of course, the less time it will take. But let's look at this result. Here I'm fetching less row because I have more predicates, but still the query time is a little bit higher. Why? Do never forget that when you have secondary index, you have the cost of reading the index file themselves, right? So this cost will add up. Also, beware of this space usage. In my unbound table, I have 110,000 records. It took me on disk, the row SS table, 6.8 megabytes of data. My country numeric text index with prefix and non-tokenizing analyzer took me only 2 megabytes. But the word is my index on the title with contains mode and standard analyzer with full text search. It took me 41 megabytes, so 6 times more than the original data. Why? Because with the contained mode, SASI will split all your data, on your text data, into substrings. So if you have a long title, you have a bunch of substrings. Okay. So be very careful when you are using contains mode. Takeaway. How does SASI compare to search engines? Elasticsearch, Solr. First question that comes to my mind. Well, Cassandra is not a search engine, sorry. It will be always slower. Why? The simple reason is when you are using a secondary index with Cassandra, SASI, or the native secondary index, you have 2 paths. 1 pass to read the index data, and 1 pass to read the original data in SS table. When you are using Solr or Elasticsearch, you are only reading the index, right? So there is no magic. There is no scoring, no ordering, no order by, because we don't want to, if you need a global order by, you need to fetch out all of your data in the cluster. We don't want to do that. No grouping, of course. So if you don't need all those features, scoring, ordering, grouping, SASI for you, fine. Sweet spots for SASI. You need multi-criteria search, and you don't need ordering, grouping, scoring. You only fetch 100 to 10,000, 1 million rows maximum. You always know the partition key, of course. This recommendation applies also to the native secondary index. If you know the partition key, the query will be restricted to a single node. Right? You want to index static columns. Well, SASI is nice because it has no penalty since the static column will address the whole partition. Avoid SASI if you have very wide partition, but now Cassandra 11.9.9.0 has been merged to trunk. So now in the new next version of Cassandra, 3.10, I believe, we will index the offset not of the partition, but of the row itself. So you won't have any issue with wide partition. If you have very strong SLA on search latency, for example, a few milliseconds, I don't know. Maybe SASI is not a good requirement. If you need ordering, sorry, SASI will not do the job.
Oh, sure. In the SASI sweet spots, number 3 right there, you said if you always know the partition key. But the index file right now, not, you know, with 197 or whatever the one that's about to be merged into the trunk is, but as it is now, it only contains the pointer to the partition. So doesn't that mean you're not really getting any gain from the index?
No. When I said you always know the partition key, it's a general advice for secondary index in general. Not only SASI, but it's also applied to native secondary index.
How does the indexing help you if you if the index file only gives you the pointer to the whole partition and not anything within the partition?
So in this case, yes. Until 3.10, SASI will index only the partition. So if you have a very a wide partition and your data, the data you are looking for is in the middle of partition, SASI will only point to the beginning of partition, and then Cassandra, we need to scan until it found.
Yeah.
But after 3.10, because this gyro ticket has been merged, we will index also the row itself, the offset of the row, and not the partition. So it will be more optimized.
Thank you. Hi. In one of your slides, I think you mentioned about the static columns, and I think that your benchmarking was also mainly with the static data. Have you performed any benchmarks with the updations, or it was just like bulk insertion one time and then you ran your queries on that?
No, I just insert a bunch of data and then do several rounds of query with Spark and then take the metrics.
Do you know like how well it performs if there is updation at the same time?
Update?
If your data is actually mutable. Mm-hmm. So how does it perform, the search,
oh,
the
if
query?
You have insert and update at the same time, and then you are doing a select to search your data, yeah. Well, it's a normal read path. So first, it will read in memory, in index mem table. What I showed before here, wait. This one, and then it will read on this for the older data, and then it will be merged by the Cassandra normal read pass. So there is nothing different than the normal Cassandra read pass.
So there is no performance hit as such, like it would still be the same?
Can you repeat the question?
It's the same path, so you mean like there would not be any performance hit?
The only performance hit I can see is because you are using a little bit more memory for the index mem table, but yeah, that's the price to pay if you want to have an index. So yeah.
So
any other question?
Yeah. So what kind of compaction strategy have you used for this benchmarking?
What is the compaction strategy
you have used for this benchmark?
Oh, this is just STSE, the standard one.
Okay.
But it is not. It is orthogonal to the compaction strategy. You can use STSC, LCS, or whatever.
Yeah, because looking at what Jonathan was explaining yesterday, if you go like bulk inserts and we try to select using SASI, there are performance impact into the mem and whatnot.
The performance impact is because now, instead of flushing just an SS table, or instead of just compacting the SS table, we need to also flush the index files and to compact the index files. So yes, you are paying a little bit more write bandwidth when you are using SASI, but it's normal. It's the same with the native secondary index anyway. So,
What about hard spark? If I have local generality field and I want to create a SASI index, is that
louder.
Hard spark issue, like SASI index, like if I have local cardinality field, like two distinct, three distinct value, I create SASI index on that.
Speak in the micro because.
What about hard spark?
Oh.
With SASI index, like if I have local cardinality field.
Okay, there is no hard spark because in fact with the native secondary index, we are saving the index data into SS table structure, right? So into a partition. And you can have wide partition and hand hotspot. With SASI, we are storing in a distinct index structure, so we don't care.
So when you do a select with the limit clause, that does not guarantee that you will get the results in the ascending order, right?
Yeah, there is no ordering guarantee. The order of the data you are getting is the order of the of this query. You know, the token ring order.
How will you compare this with using this, Solr or Elasticsearch?
How do I compare this with Solr or Elasticsearch? Well, I have the answer here. it will be slower because we are reading the index file and then SS table. If you are using Sora or Elasticsearch, you are just reading the index itself. So yeah, there is no magic. It's just physics.
The solar indexes we found it takes like 1.5 times the actual SS table size.
It depends on what you index.
On the actual text search.
Maybe.
I mean, we put the whole row on solar, and in this case, if we do a text SASI index, you said it takes 6 times the size of the SS table, right?
Yeah, because yes, you are right. Data structure, because Solar, behind Solar is Lucene, right? And data structure with Lucene are very, very optimized for full text search. This is true, yeah.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
So you need to know that SASI is not here to replace Lucene, out of question. We are just providing some facility for people to make it easier for people to do basic full text search. But if you need something really, really advanced or really very fast, a few millisecond latency, no.
All right, we got time for one last question. Over here.
Hey, one of your slides, you mentioned about to use the Spark to create a local index and to minimize the network traffic. Could you go into a little bit more detail?
This one?
Yes.
So what is the question?
So what's the benefit here?
The benefit here is, compared to that, if you are using a single Java program to fetch all the data to a single client to perform analytics, well, you will see with all the arrows that the data will be streamed on the network. Here, if you are using Spark, because you have a co-located Spark worker on top of each Cassandra process, the Spark worker will just read the local data of Cassandra with the SASI index.
But my question here is, don't we need to merge the data when we do the data actually analytics? Like, for example, if I have a Spark on node D like David, I also need the data in node A in order to do my analytic. How do you handle this?
Wait, I'm talking about the use case where you want to scan half or the full of your table. If you know that what you are getting out is a very small percentage of your table, you can use the normal client, right? This use case is when, okay, I want to fetch all of my table and filter down and to do some grouping or join on my table. And in this case, it makes sense to use Spark, call it co-located Spark.
All right, thank you.
Oh, come here.